Right, it's pretty late, and I'm filming this in my living room. I haven't put out a video in ages. Also, I'm talking a bit quiet because my family's sleeping upstairs. It's about midnight now, but I just don't get the time these days to get a video out. So in this video, I'm going to talk about the basics of setting up your camera for filmmaking. The quickest way to get cinematic results from your camera is to set the frame rate to 24 frames per second, or to be specific, it's 23.976 frames per second. Now, depending on what camera you got, if you've just got a phone, you need to get a third-party app that can allow you to unlock the full manual controls of your camera. This way, you can set to the more cinematic frame rate of 24 frames per second. The second thing that goes with frame rate is shutter speed. Now, the general rule for shutter speed is that it's always double, the number for shutter speed is always double your frame rate. So if you're shooting at 24 frames per second, your shutter speed will be 1 over 48 of a second. Sometimes you don't have these exact numbers, so any number that's close to that. So if you've got a DSLR, you might have 1 over 50 shutter speed. So that's good enough for to match to 24 frames per second. This rule is called the 180 degree shutter rule. And it doesn't have to be followed. This kind of rule is more like a guide. It gets broken all the time, especially like when you have, if you have an action sequence or you want to shoot a sequence that has a lot of motion, but not have all that motion blur that you get normally, you can increase the shutter speed and have more sort of sharper image of motion than a blurry mess. So a lot of action movies use higher shutter speeds when filming action sequences. But the general rule is to get that natural looking motion blur is shooting 24 frames per second with a shutter speed close to 48. That's a quick shortcut to a cinematic look. To me, one of the other biggest parts of getting cinematic footage is actually your lighting. I think the lighting is probably the most important, well, next to sound, but lighting design, lighting of your subject, and to set the mood of your footage, of your sequence, of your scene, is the most important part of making your footage look cinematic. There's a few different lighting methods that people use. Right now, I've got the Godox SL60W light, really affordable, like poor man's aperture 120D, people say. I don't think it's that bright as the aperture, but it does a job. It's pretty close to me, and it's just out of frame. But basically, this lighting setup that I have now is probably one of the most simplest. I've got this one big light with a light dome to diffuse that light so it comes and falls softer, and it's roughly at a 45 degree angle to my face, to where I'm sat. So what that does is it lights one side of the face up perfectly, and you expose for this. Then you should see, like, this is the Rembrandt style lighting. You should see like a kind of light triangle formed, and the rest of my face is really shadowy. This type of lighting is actually used a lot by other YouTubers and in movies as well, a lot. It's always one side of the face is lit, and what it does, it just gives your subject more depth, because if it's equal amount of light all around, and your picture's gonna look really flat. You can see now this looks quite aesthetically pleasing, this actual shot where I've got this key light on my face. I have a little bit of light, ambient light, on coming from this side, warm light, and in the back there's a little, I'll get that actually, I'll show you. This is the bowling. I don't know if you can see that if it's in focus. Bowling light, vlogger light. This is amazing RGB light. I can set to any color. It's got some funky modes there. This is probably my favorite light, and it charges by USB-C. And this I just use for kind of accent light in the background, or I can use as a hair light, just to give a bit more separation between the subject and the background. But yeah, for this case, I am just using it in like a little bit of accent light there. Here is a couple of examples of how you can light a scene with two people. I'll also show you the 180 degree rule for when you're filming a conversation. Okay, so as you can see there, we've got the lighting, yeah. So we have a key light that's coming from behind that sofa. Now, the trick here, I mean, I don't know if that looks great to you. It looks decent to me, it looks good to me. But what I've noticed in most movies is that they always film from the shadow side. So rather than the shadow side is now on, is the side that we're looking at from an angle. And then the lit side is behind. Now, if you look at any sort of two-person dialogue scenes in movies, this is a pretty common setup, lighting tactic. I mean, it makes it a little bit dramatic, I guess. And that's what movies are always going for. There's no fun in a movie if it's not got any drama. So yeah, that's a good lighting trick. Another thing you'll notice is that there's practical lighting in the background. This is always nice to have. What I've probably done wrong here is the key light doesn't really look like it's coming from anything. There seems to be a light source coming from somewhere. It's not even obvious. Maybe, like, I could use a gel on this to make it look like night light coming through a window, so I'd make it a bit blue. I can still probably do that in post, so I might change it. But yeah, this is a typical lighting setup, and even when you switch over to the other subject, and the light's coming from the same direction. But it's on the opposite side. But again, we're still on the shadow side. This is a typical setup for a dialogue scene with two people. So last but not least, to get cinematic results, is sound. Having good quality sound will make or break your short film or sequence, whatever you're filming. If you ever watch something with bad sound, you'll really notice it, and it'll really put you off the image, and you just can't really watch it. Sound is actually more important probably than picture, because some, like you just say horror movies, like a lot of it is dark and blurry and stuff, but the sound design is what sells it, it's what makes it scary, it's what ignites different emotions. Sound is really, really important, so always consider the sound design. So I'm going to wrap this up. I hope some of these tips helped if you're starting out. This is just all the stuff that I learned myself on YouTube. Everything I know I learned and teach back is stuff that I learned from YouTube, from other YouTubers, and just watching videos on how to get different results, and also just watching a load of films and stuff as well, films that I like. You don't need to write video essays or study the movie, but when you'll know when you're, I guess, a filmmaker, when you're watching a film for the first time and you start noticing how they place the lighting, how they frame the picture, the frame rates used, the shutter speeds used, that's when I guess that you know you got it, or you understand it at least. But yeah, I hope this video has helped. Any beginners, any people looking to start getting into filmmaking, I would suggest not to get any gear to start off with. You could do everything with your phone now. That's how I started. I started playing with my phone, playing with the setting. I use the Filmic Pro app, which is a great app. It cost about 15 quid. Pricey for an app, but it's probably the best there. You get free third-party apps as well that unlock the manual controls. They might have some limitations on stuff, but if you're just looking to play around with the settings and the manual controls, then yeah, just download one of the free third-party apps and get going and start filming some sequences on your phone.